Good morning. How is everyone this morning? Okay, so you're good. We have a really huge celebration today. I don't know if you guys know, but today is Charles Tilly's birthday. I think 59, are you 59 today? 59 is how old Charles is today. So be sure to give Mr. Charles a big pat on the back today for his 59th birthday. Just a few announcements, a reminder that we are having kids crew today at 4 o'clock, but we are not having youth group today. So yes, kids crew, no youth group today. And then on Friday, we are having our second family movie night. We're gonna be watching the movie Soul, which is a really cute Disney movie. We are watching the weather. It looks like it may rain, so just keep an eye out on your email on whether that may change or not, but that'll be at 7:30. We'll have hot dogs and hang out, so that'll be on Friday. And then the most wonderful Mary Marthas are meeting on the second Tuesday, which is June 8th, and they'll meet here at 9:30 for a meeting and then head out for lunch. So if you have any questions, Miss Debbie Wagner's here, and you can contact her. But if you're a Mary Martha, now if you are not a Mary Martha, and you have thought about becoming a Mary Martha, from personal experience, I can tell you it is one of the greatest things in the world. They are the greatest group of ladies. So if you've thought about becoming a Mary Martha, this is the time to do it. So see Debbie, you could see Sue, you could see me, just see any woman, be like, are you a Mary Martha? No, you're not, let's do it together. So also, I would like to introduce to you one of our interns who is here. Miss Savannah Glover is here. She is our in-person Duke intern. And then we also have an intern that's gonna be a virtual intern. So you're gonna see her kind of up on the screen. She'll be doing things later on in the service. You'll see her, and her name is Ferrell Tyndall. And so they will be our two interns for the summer term. And like I said, Savannah will be here with us, and then Ferrell, we will have her virtually, and they'll both be doing a lot of things. We've got a long list for them this summer, so we're excited to have them. We're excited for you to be here, our second Sunday in person here in church. It's so good to see your smiling eyes, and so thanks for coming to church. If you would please stand, if you're able, and grab your bulletins and join me in the call to worship. Creator God, call us all.
You declare, O Lord, that our sons and daughters prosper. The humble civilians, our elders bring dreams.
Resurrected Christ, guide us all. Holy, holy, holy Spirit, move us to action.
So that us who hold like water, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream.
Take away all guilt. except that which is good. We offer our worship, the fruit of our lips, to you, our God. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. As Amanda mentioned, we are blessed to have our two new interns with us this summer, and one will be sharing with us virtually her gifts. So we have our opening prayer today brought to us by Ferrell, Tyndall, as she brings a good word for us virtually this day. Let us pray.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you have given to us your servant's grace, confession of a true faith, to acknowledge the glory of the eternal Trinity, the power of your divine majesty to worship the unity. Keep us steadfast in this faith and worship, and bring us at last to see you in your one and eternal glory of Father.
Well, good morning again. It's good to be here and to see our children, especially on this Memorial Day weekend and Trinity Sunday. Last week, as you may remember, who remembers what we did last week? Anybody? What did we talk about in the children's time? Yeah, we started out with the ABCs of faith, right? We talked about A, standing for amen. B, can you, anybody look in their bags and tell me what the B was for, if you remember? If they're in your bags? Okay, you took them out. There's one. There you go. Thank you, Kennedy. That's be kind. Yes, we're in the B. And then C, celebration, because it was Pentecost Sunday. And this is another Sunday to celebrate because it is Trinity Sunday. So we're going to continue on with the ABCs of faith. We're going to get three more letters today, and we're going to start off with D, the big word, doxology. Now, doxology means to praise God. And typically, when the past, when we worshiped pre-COVID, we would have the offering, and then we would sing the doxology. And of course, since we're not singing right now out loud, we're going to sing in our hearts and in our minds, and we're going to hear the doxology as it's played for us. And so I invite everybody to listen to it, and in particular, the words of Trinity in it, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. So nothing like being put on the spot to play a song, but we're going to play the doxology and again sing it in our hearts this day. A beautiful song, isn't it? It's just so pretty. And it's also a great song to sing as a blessing. So kids, today maybe after church when you have lunch or dinner tonight, sing the doxology in honor of Trinity Sunday. Then our next letter, E, for, and we'll hear this again, eternity, for the gift that we receive in believing in Jesus Christ. God is with us from the very beginning of time until the very end of time. Our triune God is eternal. So E for eternity. And then F, the word faith. Because as Christians, it is important for us to carry this faith with us, to have it in our hearts, to share it with the world, and to be people filled with faith. So we're going to go over letters again. D for doxology, E for eternity, and F for faith. Now next week we'll have a few more letters to go in, but we're going to start back to the beginning. Our first letter was A, and then our first word was amen, what we always say in prayer. So kids, if y'all can fold your hands, prayer hands, and we're going to say a word of prayer and thanksgiving. Lord God, we give thanks for this Trinity Sunday that you are a triune God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And as the song doxology reminds us, our lives are called to praise you. To give thanks for the gift of eternity, to give thanks that by grace you give us the gift of faith to follow you, to be your servants, and to bless others with the good news that we are called to share. Be with our dear children as they learn these ABCs of faith. Remind us always to be kind and to celebrate the gifts that you have given us. In Jesus' holy name we pray.
Thank you. Let us stand while our scripture is read. I'll be reading from John, the third chapter, verses 1 through 17. Nicodemus visits Jesus. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh. What is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Verily, verily, truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life." For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through you. Word of God for the people of God.
Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Well, it was nighttime, and there Nicodemus, this Pharisee, is asking Jesus a question, knowing that Jesus is the great teacher, playing the part of the student. At nighttime, when it's dark, when hopefully no one will see him. Imagine for a moment not wanting to be the kid in the class who asks a dumb question. Teachers always say, you can never ask a stupid question, but there are, we know, some stupid questions. I'm not going to name them. And this seems like it could be a stupid question. He can't be seen with Jesus. He's a Pharisee. They don't get along, we know, in the scriptures. If we don't remember to jog our memory a little bit, just check out Matthew 23:1-39. Here are some of the words from the Message translation. The religious scholars and Pharisees are competent teachers in God's law. You won't go wrong following their teachings on Moses, but be careful about following them. They talk a good line, but they don't live it. They don't take it into their hearts and live it out in their behavior. It's all spit and polished veneer. Goes on to say later in the scripture, their lives are like, and you've got to love the Message for this, their lives are like perpetual fashion shows, embroidered prayer shawls one day and flowery prayers the next day. Now Nicodemus, he wonders out loud at night, asking Jesus what perplexes him, asking these questions, serving as the student. He says, how can someone be born again if they're old? Surely they can't enter their mother's womb a second time to be born. Now, of course, if we had been in class, we may have been the student who would have laughed at these questions if we had heard them. Get with the program, Nicodemus. I can almost imagine a good scholar saying, get with the program. He's talking about the Holy Spirit. Remember that gift we received from Pentecost, the new birth, being born of the Spirit? It's natural, as the Pharisees describe him. We can think about him on the outside. He looks good, but he's impatient, wanting to know the truth. As the Pharisees often get described, sadly, in the scripture, looking good on the outside, but almost in the end, being kind of like Halloween is their everyday of their life. The outfit could change, but the heart and mind may not. But here we have this good news. Flesh gives way to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to the Spirit. And then, of course, as it was beautifully read by Lorraine earlier, some of the most famous scripture of all that we hear this day from John 3:16. Just get on a highway and you can see a billboard that will share this good news. Back in the day when every football game was crowded with folks, there would probably be somebody in the fields or in the crowds holding up a sign, John 3:16, trying to fan the flames of good news. Or even a football player, right? The famous Tim Tebow, especially if you're a University of Florida fan. Do we have any in there? I don't think so. My husband would be like, I can't believe you just asked that question. We're University of Tennessee fans. Anyways, but having that under his eye and sharing this good news, Tim Tebow still shares a good scripture out as he recently shared another word from the Gospel of John. God is in spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and truth. John 4:24. But we know this verse because it seems to encapsulate all of the good news, this freedom that we have in our Savior Jesus Christ, the eternal life that we receive through him. And while there's no mention of the Holy Spirit in this verse, we know that it's the Holy Spirit that makes it possible for us to love our God, to turn to him. To love God is not something we can do on our own accord. The Holy Spirit enables us to have that love for God. The Holy Spirit empowers us to love God and to love others, guides us so that we can share this good news. And yes, beloved, the Holy Spirit is quite the gift that makes new birth possible in God. As Christians gather around the world today to celebrate this holy day of Trinity, I'm always reminded of Trinity Sunday, of a professor I had in divinity school. He had this great British accent, taught Orthodox Christianity, and he would say, almost like a quiz every time we met in Christian theology, he would say, now when I say God, and I can't do the British accent, I'm too Southern, I guess. And we would all respond, I mean God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. But interestingly enough, there aren't many places in Scripture that talk about God as a triune God. I'm going to share a few of them for you. Matthew 28:19, if you're taking notes. 1 Peter 1:2. And then 2 Corinthians 13:14, which is often a beautiful benediction that we hear. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Blessing us with this word today, John reminds us that even the most well-informed scholars among them, this informed leader of the faith, the Pharisee Nicodemus, has questions. It reminds us it's okay to have questions. And before we begin putting down Pharisees too much, yes, there are those woes we just shared, but they also bring wonderful things about faith to light. Pharisees were ones who emphasized the oral tradition, looking at the details of Scripture. How do you live it out? Which we see that in his questions today. They were ones who wanted to put faith into practice, not just live it in the synagogue and in the temple. No, they would have to go and share it every day. Faithfulness was essential. And then Pharisees, unlike Sadducees, believed in the gift of eternal life. Nicodemus doesn't put up a fight. Even though at times we hear this, we may want to put up a little bit of fight. For we know these words, we know this familiar passage, and yet still we find ourselves perhaps too asking questions to God in dark moments in our lives. Because we too need light that sometimes we just can't see. We pray, Lord, pour your light upon us so that we can shine bright for others. Even our founder, John Wesley, struggled with his faith. He went over to Georgia. Here I go with all these SEC schools today. He went to Georgia to be a missionary, to share the good news to folks. But yet he even found himself not having an assurance of faith. Kind of like the Moravians we know in Winston-Salem and their heritage, also in Georgia. There was a Moravian pastor, and get his name, it was August Sangenberg. What a name, Sangenberg. Anyways, Wesley, being the great note taker that he was, wrote down the questions that perplexed his soul. These questions were asked of him, a great preacher and evangelist. Have you the witness within yourself? Does the Spirit of God bear witness to your spirit that you are a child of God? And Wesley admitted that he found within himself wondering, well, yes, I believe in the gift of salvation. Yes, I know that Jesus is the Savior of the world. But do you know that he has saved you? Do you know this for yourself? And he said, I do. But as soon as he said it, he feared that his words were in vain. And his faith goes on to be ups and downs as we hear the struggles of assurance and faith. But for Wesley, new birth was critical. It was as critical in the 18th century, as critical as it was when Nicodemus and Jesus were talking, as critical as it is today. In sharing the words of good news in the gospel, Brennan Manning shares it this way. He says, the gospel is absurd, and the life of Jesus is meaningless unless we believe that he lived and that he died and he rose again with one purpose in mind, to make in us a brand new creation. Not to make us better people with better morals, but to create a community of prophets and people that go and share, men and women that share in this good news, that surrender ourselves to the mystery of the fire of the Holy Spirit that is to burn within us with this presence of the Word of God, so that it becomes the center of all of who we are, the very heart and mystery of Christ. And that flame burns and consumes and refines, giving us peace and joy and boldness. For that, our friends, is what it means to be a Christian. Now, these two friends were talking, and the last one confessed. He said, you know, last week I ran a half marathon. The other friend, kind of surprised by this news, said, really? He said, well, no, not really. But it sounds much better than saying I quit halfway through the marathon. Nicodemus doesn't quit, though, to his misunderstanding to Jesus. Jesus answers him, how can someone be born when they are old? Nicodemus asks, surely they can't get in a second time into their mother's womb to be born. And still, his answer doesn't make sense, even to this person of deep knowledge, even from the Rabboni, the Messiah, Jesus himself. And again he asks, how can this be? So Jesus tries again. He talks about faith in God, how we will not perish but have the gift of everlasting life. And maybe not as quite as famous as John 3:16, although arguably maybe it should be John 3:17. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Jesus came to save us, we know, to free us, so that we don't live in condemnation, that we have the gift of eternal life, that we know his holy ways, that the Spirit is poured out upon us to empower us to break free the bondage of sin and death. And this is the good news, brothers and sisters, that we share. the good news we are called to share, not one of condemnation. Jesus pulls Nicodemus out of the darkness, for Jesus is the light of the world. He calls us to be the light in the world. A few chapters later, John chapter 8, verse 12, we read, "And again Jesus spoke to them, saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." The other night, Jets and my husband, who, yes, is a UT family, that's where he went to school, but anyways, we were sitting outside, and it was a beautiful summer night on the screen-in porch, and it was dark. And our youngest, she doesn't know this is happening, but anyway, she comes outside on the screen-in porch, and she jumps up with hands up in the air and kind of like a half jumping jack split, and she goes, "Do you know what time of year it is?" And I thought to myself, well, as a pastor, I'm thinking, well, we just had Pentecost, and we're going into Trinity Sunday, but I don't know what today is. And she said, it's, and this was a cute kind of reading part, she goes, "It's firefly season." And I want to say it's lightning bugs, but it's firefly season. And she saw them outside, the fireflies that were flickering out in the air. And it was drizzling a little bit, but she got her sister, and they ran out like kids, I think, should do, in the backyard with their hands cusped, looking for these beautiful creatures that would light up. They would hold them, and then they would let them go. And to me, it gives me this image of how our faith should be, beloved. We are called to capture this beautiful light that God has given us as the Spirit flows like the wind and the rain and even in the light of the lightning bugs. We are called to run towards it, to claim it in our hands, and then to let it go and to share in this amazing good news of everlasting life. The light of the world is with us. You and I are the light of God that we are called to share and shine in our lives. May it be that we too know the good news, that it is okay to wander out loud. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy
to a time of prayer. If you are unfamiliar with our quilt ministry, it is quite the ministry. You can see two beautiful examples up here of our prayer quilts. We've been doing this for many, many years, and as a recent recipient of a prayer quilt. There's nothing like curling up under your prayer quilt, seeing all those little tiny knots, and knowing that people you maybe don't even know has prayed for you. It means so much. So, Brenda, do you know how many we've already done this year? Have we hit 100? Not yet this year. Oh, we did 100 last year. Okay. 23 this year. So you can see how many quilts we do, and our quilts have gone all over the world. All over the world, all over our country, and also our community. So thank you for your prayer quilts. And in our new bulletin, our quilts are listed on the back, also our prayer requests. We invite you to take these home, put it on your fridge, and this be your daily prayer list throughout the week. So our first quilt here on this side is for Bobby Borland Cabe. Bobby works with Jolinda Swiggett, and she is undergoing treatment for non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. And then this beautiful one over here is for Lambert Cates from Eflin, and he is Fading Canada's brother, and he's in the hospital with some health concerns. So please be sure to keep these two brothers and sisters in Christ in your prayers this week.
Well, good morning, church. As Laura and Amanda said earlier, I'm Savannah Glover, the new intern here at Walnut Grove, and I'm so excited to be with you all for the summer. As we continue in this time of prayer, like Amanda said, you can find the prayer requests on the back of your bulletin. And this week we are lifting up Bobby Borland, Kate, Sandy Combs, Kelly Apple, the family of John DeFabio, and Gail Barber, and also Jay Barry's dad, Daniel, who's recently put in the hospital. So if you would, bow your heads in a time of prayer with me. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for this day. God, we pray for the names on this prayer list and the names in our hearts. God, we pray for your holy church in the world and for Walnut Grove, that we may all be as one body in Christ. God, grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you, that your name may be glorified by all people. We pray for the leaders of this church, that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments. And God, we pray for those who govern and hold authority in the world, that there may be justice and peace on earth. God, give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake, that our words, that our works may find favor in your sight. And Lord, have compassion on those who suffer grief or hold troubles in their heart, that they may be delivered from their distress. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetually shine upon them. And God, we praise you for the saints who have entered joy. May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom. Let us pray in silence for the persons and needs still on our hearts. God, we ask all of these things in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Today for our ministry moment, we wanted to highlight our new family movie night that we're doing. We've had one event so far, like I spoke earlier. We have another one coming up this Friday, and it's been a ton of fun. What we were looking for was just an opportunity for all of us to be able to kind of gather together and have a good time. It's been so long since we've been able to do things like that together and just have fun. So we wanted to create this, especially for our kids. Our kids are mostly out of school now. I think you got a week left, right, of school. And so they're almost out of school. 4 more days? 4 more days until school's out. Yay!
I'm already out.
Oh, okay. Mikey's already out of school, okay? All right, so some are out. Some have 4 more days. If you have 4 more days, we are praying for your 4 more days, okay? But we wanted this to be something fun for our kids to be able to see each other. And if you were able to come last time, it was so much fun. Bailey Rath brought over one of his handmade cornhole boards. And the kids, who I don't think actually know how to play cornhole, figured out how to play their own game of cornhole. But just to see them play, and we all shared, we had hot dogs together, chips, ring pops. I think there was a proposal between two kids, but anyways. But it was just a fun opportunity to be together. We have a huge inflatable projection screen. It is enormous. And we've set it up in the parking lot. The youth used it to do pilgrimage. And that's what we project the movie on. Bring our lawn chairs. It's just a fun time to be together. We play movies that the kids are going to like. So that's why we started the family movie night, was a chance to just kind of get together and have a good time. So if you're available on Friday, I hope you are, please come out. We'll start at 7:30. And we usually just hang out and play some games until it gets dark enough to project the movie. But this is something that we want to do throughout the summer. So, and hey, maybe it'll catch on and maybe we'll do it more. So please consider coming to our family movie night. We would love to see you and just hang out and fellowship together.
Thank you.
beloved, receive this benediction. Lord God, your name is above all other names. You come to us as the triune God, with us in the beginning, and will be with us until our dying breath. We give thanks, Lord, for the community of saints gathered here this day to praise you, to give thanks for your holy word and message of good news and salvation. Guide us, Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit, empowering us in your ways to shine your light in this world, to wonder out loud at your mighty deeds. For the gift of salvation, we give you praise and lift you on high. This day and always, our almighty Savior Jesus Christ, by your name we pray.